This is TWiT.
Let's jump in because we do actually have a rare opportunity to talk about a news story that didn't just break, but is still breaking. And one that, unlike a lot of other tech stories, the non-tech press has picked up and ran with it because it is so big and it's so impactful. Of course, we're talking about WannaCry. Now, there's a couple of things that we know about WannaCry. We know that it was developed from the leaked Eternal Blue that was released by the Shadow Brokers. That was an NSA tool, which, by the way, one of the very first reporters to pick up this story was our very own Kurt Franklin, who is a co-host on This Week in Enterprise Tech. Now, we know that the initial infection was via emailed link or attachment. So this was it looked like a phishing attack. But once infected, a computer would check a domain to see if it responded. It would exploit an SMB vulnerability in some versions of Windows in order to spread laterally. So once you had a computer on a network that was infected, it could infect other vulnerable computers on that network. Then it installed the double pulsar backdoor, which was interesting because that would stay even if you paid the ransom, because this is cryptoware. Mm-hmm. And of course, it would demand $300 in Bitcoins. Now, we have to wait for the numbers because they're still kind of trickling in. But anecdotally, it looks like we're talking about over 200,000 systems. It's probably going to end up being in the 500,000 systems by the time this thing is done. It seems as if XP is taking the brunt of the attack. 10, as far as we know, is not vulnerable. 8, I think unless you've got one of the very first versions, it's not vulnerable. So we're talking about XP, Vista, and Windows 7. But Windows 7 probably not, because it's probably been patched. Now, again, the first impact was hundreds of thousands of systems, followed by 150 countries, including Europe, Asia, some of the Americas.
Continents, not countries.
Continents. Continents, yes. It shut down manufacturing at Renault in France and Romania, shut down manufacturing at Nissan in England. It also affected, and this was the big one, this is the one that caught people's attention, health services in Britain, which evidently are running Windows XP. And you actually had to have patients who were diverted because systems weren't working. The intake systems weren't working. Now, let's start with that, because that's a good background. Is this, as people are calling it, this is the very first worldwide cyber attack? I mean, the one that people have looked to and said, okay, this is what we were waiting for. It's finally here.
I don't know if I go ahead and say it's the absolute first one, but it certainly meets the scale we've been promised. People say this is going to come, this is going to happen. Eventually, down the pike, it's going to whack you in the face super hard. And this is at least meeting that bill of sale. I mean, there was actually a photo I saw on Twitter on the way up here of a Russian train like control area, and some of their screens were actually just blocked off with the same malware we saw a second ago, and so they couldn't run the trains. I mean, this was global and systemic across our important infrastructure and our life. So I think it meets all thresholds of crisis.
Yeah. Christina, what about it? Is this the digital Pearl Harbor?
I mean, I don't know if it's that, but it could be. I mean, it certainly had the potential to be. I mean, at least the first attack was mitigated, but now we have all of these other variants that are coming out. It's certainly scary. I mean, I think it could be.
Yeah.
Why do they only ask for $300?
It's actually very well studied. That's the pain threshold.
Really?
So below $300 and below, people are saying that's less than the time it would take me to fix my system. Above $300, people are saying I'll just go to a backup.
Yeah.
So the $300 is the sweet spot, pain point, whatever, that thing. That's amazing. Because, I mean, I was told that all the crypto from this is flowing to three separate wallets total. But, I mean, it can't be that much money in aggregate if it's only $300 per. I heard one of like 30K in it. But, I mean, to me, the amount of chaos has been caused for the small dollar amount is really out of whack. Like, what a bit of mischief for, like, some change. I mean, a lot for me personally.
Well, I mean, if you're just building, if you want to do it for the lulls, or you just want for a little bit of cash, or, you know, they might be looking at, local laws, like anything above a certain amount would, you know, go from a misdemeanor to a felony or whatever. Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of things. Plus, like you said, the threshold, if you're more likely to get $300 than $5,000.
Right.
Because you're just like, you know what? I'll just go to the bank. I'll get $300. We'll pay it. We just want this off of here.
They've actually done studies about this, because this is not the first crypto ransom software we've seen in the wild. Where, $600, that's too much. People won't pay $600 on the most part, unless it compromised a vital system. Versus $300, which is three Bitcoin, or less than a third of a Bitcoin. That's something that people are willing to look at and say, you know what, it's worth me not being annoyed.
I just love it that it's 17.6% of a Bitcoin is fine. 0.5 Bitcoin, way too much. I won't do it.
But regular people don't think in Bitcoin. Well, they just say $300. They're like, you know what? That's less than an Xbox or whatever. I could just pay it and be done with it.
I mean, I've read things before, and I don't know how it works in this case, but I know that in other ransomware attacks, you know, even getting people who are willing to pay the $300, going through the process of buying in Bitcoin and going through that is a challenge in and of itself. And so you wonder, too, like, there might be people who are willing to pay $300, but aren't willing to go through the hassle of going through a Bitcoin exchange and signing up for those accounts and connecting things and setting up a wallet and transferring stuff over, you know? So you have to wonder too, like how much potential, why maybe the amounts are less just because depending on who your target is, they might not be willing or able to go through that process.
That all sounds very valid, but the fact that they shut down the NHS for less than the price of a 3-day pass to outside lands, ironic in some ways. Right. It's kind of funny to me.
Like, they don't know where it's going to go, though. I mean, they release it into the wild, and they just assume it's going to hit certain computers that are vital.
Yeah. I know, that's so irresponsible. I mean, Robbie made a good point about, absolutely, like, for the lulz. You can't be that indiscriminate and that awful for the lulz, unless you really have
That's really what for the lulz is, though.
Plus, if
you look at it and you say, okay, what percentage of computers are running Windows 95? What percentage of computers are not patched? And you're just like, you know what? If we just ask for $300, every single hospital, there's a lot of hospitals, that's $300. Every single small mom and pop shop, $300. Every single little place, it's still running Windows 95 because A, they can't afford to update their hardware or their software, or B, they're using legacy software that they need for their business. A lot of hospitals have to use old stuff for their business. Yeah. It's, you know, people are like, why didn't you patch it? We're like, well, because if they do, it'll break something that's very important to keeping somebody alive somewhere.
There was a great thread on Twitter, I think from a Microsoft employee who works on .NET stuff, and he was kind of talking about how, you know, these $15 million like MRI machines are running Windows XP embedded because when the machines were created, that was the most up-to-date and modern embedded system you could use. But the manufacturer might be gone, and you know in getting a patch and getting things done is very complicated, and there are a lot of things that go into why something can or can't be updated. And it's not simple as to say, we'll just update it because maybe the manufacturer isn't in business, or maybe, you know, support has been outsourced out to a lot of different areas. And as you were saying, you know, Robert, like if you know, updating one thing could break a bunch of other things and air gapping and things like that and isolating things on the network is great, but you still need systems that need to talk to one another. It's a really complex problem to solve, especially when you're looking at organizations like the NHS or hospitals in general where funds are cut all the time and they don't have big budgets to have people security as up-to-date and as much of a priority as it is. And it becomes very expensive to look at replacing certain systems that are working just because of something else. You know, it's a really, really complicated problem when you start talking about these sorts of very important vital systems, you know, like hospitals. But I think that whoever created this, I mean, that'll be a very interesting thing, is to figure out who's behind this, depending on what part of the world they're from. Even $300, even $30,000 could be a lot of money to them. Right. And then if this continues to go on and affect more and more users and more people pay up, it could you know, that money, that the value for them could go up too.
Well, let's talk a little bit about the mitigation, because here's a few of the things that we know. We know that it didn't hit the United States as hard as it hit Europe for a couple of reasons. One, we're on weekend, so everything is shut down already. Two, by the time it rolled around to the United States, people knew about the attack, and so the phishing emails were being blocked upstream.
Right.
So that really, really helped. And then, of course, there was the accidental discovery. There's a British researcher. All we know is that he's known as @MalwareTechBlog. He works for an LA-based threat intelligence company, but he lives probably in Southwest England. He was looking at the traffic that the malware was generating, and he noticed that it was beaconing to a domain that did not exist. Mm-hmm. And so he registered the domain, and the attacks abated. If you were already infected, it didn't work. But if the malware tried to install itself on the system and it did receive a ping back from the from that entry, which was WannaCry.com or WannaCry.org, then it wouldn't install itself. It was a kill switch. So he found that.
By accident,
but it worked. It very much mitigated it. Now, here's the fun part, and I really want to get your input on this, because you've got the non-tech press, and even some of the tech press, CNET, CBS, got caught up in this saying, well, that was a bad attack, wasn't it? And it's as if, oh, it's over. And it's like, no. In fact, this, you know, this morning, we've had security researchers who have been verifying on Twitter, there is a second variant in the wild, and they removed the kill switch. That will not work anymore.
That took what, 12 hours?
Yeah, I mean, not even that.
If it was that simple to take down, you can correct that mistake. But, I mean, for $11 and some experimentation, points to that guy for saving a lot of people a lot of bother.
Yeah. Like, absolutely.
Like, props. When I read that story, I thought it was almost like a joke. Like, this can't really be what happened. That's amazing. It also shows the power of one person tinkering around the edges, even against a global catastrophe. I like that idea.
Yeah, it was, from what I understand, it was just a standard honeypot. So he had a Windows XP honeypot. He had a tap. He watched the infection traffic, and then he's like, oh, what's this domain? Oh, it's not registered. Let me register it. Oh, wow, that fixed it.
Yeah. I can track it with this tap. I can track the pings coming from all the different IPs, and he's like, oh, well, I fixed it. And of course, everyone can be just like, the person who made the variant is just like, oh, well.
Yeah, let me just take that. It was literally, let me just take out that check.
Here we go.
It's not going to check anymore.
Back out in the world.
Well, the story that I read about this particular solution was that when they first did it, they thought they made a mistake and had made it worse. And they were like, oh, no. And they were freaking out. And then it turns out, no, it's the direct opposite. But can you imagine the emotional whiplash you would go through? Like, wow, what's this? I've made it worse. Never mind. I saved the world. Like, I mean, that's a really big 3 minutes. I don't know if I can take that kind of turmoil.
That's an emotional roller coaster.
Yes, really, indeed. It is.